Hello and welcome to episode 8 of Good Game Roundtable. I'm Lin Jie Kong, and yes, the podcast finally has a name. I submitted it to iTunes a few days ago and decided to put together some new artwork and name it after the lovely roundtable that we gather around to record. So hopefully some of you will be able to access episodes on iTunes in the near future, as well as continue to do so on SoundCloud. So on to this week, and it's all about getting to know you, getting to know all about you. As we welcome three newbies on the Good Game team this year. Production assistant Sanita Khandharixay.
Yay.
Did I say it right?
You did say it right.
Woohoo! Junior film producer Tobias Venus.
Hello.
And editor Paul Nunes?
Nunes.
Oh, yeah. I got one out of three, or two out of three. Tobias Venus, that's
Tobias
right.
Tobias Venus, yeah.
Excellent. Hello, everyone.
Hello.
Hi.
How are you guys all doing this week?
Good. It's just a very quiet Friday.
Mm. Yeah, quiet Fridays are good. Take your rest whilst you can. So the core of the GG team have actually been together now for about 5 to 6 years, and we usually might add one extra new member each year. And it's unprecedented that we have three new members in 1 year.
Aren't we lucky?
You guys are very lucky. So I guess for you guys, it's cool because you can kind of talk to each other about the wackiness of joining Good Game, right?
Yeah.
But before we get into, I guess, a podcast all about knowing you guys, what did you guys think of the Rogue One trailer that dropped overnight?
Well, I thought it looked kind of good in that it felt sort of fresh, and like there was a lot less pressure on the film to be like, oh, this is the comeback of Star Wars and we have to do all these things right. It felt like more relaxed and like they're having fun in the Star Wars universe.
So yeah, absolutely.
I'm looking forward to that sort of laid back, like, let's just do something super, super fun. We don't have to stress about it so much.
Yeah, I liked a lot that was in the trailer, and there were some moments that made me feel, okay, this could get messy if it gets really bad, but then there were some great things in there which made it seem like it would be a lot of fun to watch. Toby, what did you think?
My first thought while I was watching it was, damn, Ben's not going to be here to explain it all to me when I come into the office. I don't know a huge amount of Star Wars, so I was wondering if some of the characters were people we knew or not. But either way, I think it's going to be great to see a bunch of Star Wars movies come out that aren't part of the original saga, that focus on some of the other aspects of the Star Wars universe, because it's massive, and I don't think we see as much as we should have been, really.
Absolutely. I really hope they keep a different tonal outlook for all these movies.
Yeah.
You know, they make a difference between the standalones and the new saga trilogy, because I don't want it to turn into like the Marvel universe or the DC universe, yes, where all the films are very similar. Like, I want kind of independence and, you know, difference between them.
Yeah, some freshness.
Yeah.
I think Pete said today it'll act more like a CIA spy sort of Star Wars movie, if it was any sort of genre. Is that...
Yeah, he was saying that he felt it was a little bit like the MI6 of Star Wars, and that all these agents are going in to infiltrate, you know, the Empire, which is pretty cool, I think.
I've heard the alarm going off quite a few times today coming out of the Pocket Studio. I think Pete's watched it about 6 times already.
Yeah, he's got it memorized now.
Yeah, the alarm sound was heaps funny. It made me laugh out loud when I heard it. I'm like, just...
It sounds like someone just talking into a mic. Going,
So coming new to the Star Wars office, Good Game office. I mean, we'll get into kind of experiencing Good Game for the first time. But Sanita, for example, coming in, did you realize how big Star Wars fans we all are?
Actually, I kind of expected it, because I didn't get a tour of the office or anything. But I remember seeing you guys on Facebook all watching the Star Wars trailer together. Mm. And I was like, oh, okay, I can fit in with these guys.
So, yeah, these guys are nerds. Yeah, like, I'll be fine.
So I knew you guys were fans. But then when I actually stepped into the office, I was like, oh, I might have to brush up on a lot of things.
Yeah, I may have to go out and buy some more Star Wars toys now.
Next level, which is exactly what I did, actually. As a reward for getting this job, I got like an old 1986 or something Millennium Falcon, one of the big toys with all the buttons on it, which is sitting in my editing suite right
now. So that's the one, I saw that yesterday. I didn't know if that was yours or not.
Yeah, that was my present to myself.
Aww.
Yeah. On the same day that I got that, some of my my friends bought a house and they were on Facebook. They're like super proud. They're like, oh, we bought a house. And I was like, well, look what I invested in today. I think we all know who's the winner.
Exactly. So. Yeah, we all know you're the winner, Paul. All right. So tell me your life histories. How did you get to this point? Paul, let's start off with you.
All right. It all started with Pong. But actually, yeah, we had Pong. Like in my family, I remember that, like, it was like the controllers was like an analog dial, and they had the soccer mode and the tennis mode and the squash mode, and then we plugged into the analog TV and you had to tune the TV to the right channel. So playing that, and then, you know, I went to the Atari 2600, and I think probably one of the defining moments that made me want to like really care about gaming really seriously and go, no, this is important, needs to be nurtured and looked after, right? So I was playing, like, the Atari had a flight sim, I don't remember the name of it, and like it was like a mission where you start off on a thing and you fly up, you do some dog fighting, and then you have to land at night, and then you take off again, do a night mission, right? And I could never land the plane. Like, I read the manual over and over, and I just must have played it literally hundreds of times, and I only got to land once. And just as I landed, I was having this incredible high where it was like, I finally did it, I finally get to see the rest of the game, this is so exciting. And my parents were like, right, we're going for a Sunday drive, come on. And of course, you know, they don't have any, there's no saves or anything, right? So I was just like, no, you don't understand, this is really important, I've done this, I've never managed to do it before. You guys go, just leave me, I need to concentrate, this is really important. And my dad, after a long conversation, he got fed up and he just unplugged it.
Oh,
and I was just like, you know what, I think,
oh no,
that,
you didn't, dad.
Yeah. So, and I think at that point, like, obviously I was spewing and I was just a kid, but like that point I was like, this is like really important and people don't understand. So I think, yeah, that was probably a defining moment. Certainly stands out in my mind as like an emotional moment with gaming.
And that's where it all started. So
I think so.
Before editing, you actually worked in games. You
that's
actually
right.
did sound design. Tell us a bit about that.
That's right. So I was working film, and I sort of wasn't especially happy with how my career was going. I felt like it was stagnating. And then I just thought, I like games so much more than I like films. Why am I not concentrating on that? What are some transferable skills that I have from films? And I thought, oh, audio, awesome. Sound design, I'm going to do sound design and dynamic mixing. You know, this is exciting. It was exactly at the year of the GFC.
Oh.
And I thought, you know, maybe it's a good time to start, you know, like, sure, there's not going to be a lot of work or anything, but it's going to take me time to sort of get contacts and I'm rebooting my career. Well, to cut a long story short, eventually I started working on a mod called Dystopia. It's a Half-Life 2 mod that had been, you know, really popular for a while, was still in development. There was new maps and stuff. There was a good community around it. The folks on that team took me on board, and I flew over to the States to meet them, and it was really fun. We started a company after that. It was really great. You know, a lot of the sounds that are in Dystopia I've recorded locally around here in Sydney, like a lot of the industrial zones. I'd go out there and do like heaps of field recording things and make the ambient sounds for the maps and things like that. After a few years of that, we did some commercial titles like Blade Symphony. Or we did a commercial title before I left the team. And I got to work on some other Australian games as well, such as Particulars, which, you know, I'm very proud of my work on that one.
Awesome. And did you study audio engineering or sound design at school, or did you just manage to fall into it?
Mostly, I did study a lot of sound. I did a Masters of Digital Media at COFA. And that, and I focused as much as I could on audio. I had a really fantastic audio teacher there who was literally inspirational. Probably well known by many people as Pauline Pantsdown.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
Yeah. But like, yeah, he's a really fantastic teacher, so experienced and really inspirational to my desire to work in audio and be good at it.
And how did you go from audio to editing?
Well, because I'd been working in film beforehand and I still had some contract work the whole time, so I was sort of editing the whole time here and there. That was a lot of the film work that I was doing before I switched into games.
Yeah, fantastic. And now you're at Good Game, where you can combine your love of gaming with editing.
It's right.
Perfection.
Yeah,
perfection,
right. Right.
Yeah, you'll be here for another 30 years.
Yes.
Sanita, how about you?
Okay, so I started off with my gaming siblings, my older brother, my older sister. My older brother, introduced me into games probably since I was a kid, and that's how we sort of grew up doing it together. So my first loves was Crash Bandicoot and Spyro.
Yeah.
And I also loved our other little titles that we had on our little PS1. I'd come home from school, I'd play some games with my sister or my brother, and that's just how it just became habitual, and it was a thing that I did that I was always a kid from till I was a teenager throughout to uni till now. I'm still like going home and playing games.
Yep.
Yeah, but I started off drawing a lot. I was doing a lot of drawing, I was doing a lot of painting, and then when I got through to high school, I was like, you know what, I really love doing art, so I'm gonna try and aim to become an artist of some sort. And then I was introduced into digital art, and I'm fascinated with gaming worlds and gaming characters, and I love art books and art styles, so I tried to do that. I went ahead and I did a digital media degree.
Yay.
But I did it in Wollongong. Awesome. And I would stay up until like 2 or 3 a.m. just practicing my drawing, practicing my art. But it's tough. Like, it's really tough, especially when you live in, I guess, I don't want to say like, just Australia. Mm. It's hard to be an artist or an illustrator. And,
absolutely, yeah.
You know, my skills aren't up to par as other artists, other people. And I thought, okay, so maybe I could do something else. So when I was doing digital media, I was also learning film, TV, audio, animation and that. And I was just doing contract work, like editing, being like an art department runner for a couple of short films or TV and that kind of stuff. And then I just thought, something is like not right. Like, there's no way I can't be an artist, because it's very difficult. Mm. So I'm like, I'm just going to keep that as a hobby.
Yeah.
And then I realized, well, I'm kind of good at business. Like, I'm very good with putting things together and admin or organization. So I went ahead and I did entertainment business management.
Mm-hmm.
And that was very, very, very good. Like, Lynn's seen my work that I've done when I was interviewed by her.
Yeah, this is why you got the job.
So I was doing a lot of, you know, budgeting, a lot of Excel, you know, and this role came along and I thought, oh, okay, I'm sure I can do that, and it's for something I love, and I know what to do, which is video games and TV. Mm-hmm. And I can still be an artist on the side, but now there's just something that really shows that what I can do. So I do all the organizational things and pick up, and yeah. So that's how we came here.
Yeah, it's interesting that you mentioned that journey of finding where your skill set is, right? And I think for a lot of younger people, it's similar journey of where you have that passion, but then once you actually find a certain skill set that you're like, oh, I'm really actually good at this, and I can actually fit into this role. That's really cool.
Like, it was actually really rough deciding to do another degree, because a lot of people were asking me, well, then why did you waste 3 years at Wollongong? And I was like, but I didn't.
You never waste those years in education.
I had a beautiful time at Wollongong. I lived on campus. I met a lot of people from overseas. They all thought I was a big, big fat nerd, like, because all I do is talk about video games. And then I had a lot of people question, like, why are you going to do another degree? And people had a lot of misconception about the degree I did, because they thought it was a music-based degree. They were calling it music business, and I was saying no, it's entertainment business management. And I tried my hand at, like, you know, crafting the assignments towards a various streams, like music or film, but I would always somehow focus on video games as well. Again, the weird kid, just the only kid talking about video games.
In Good Game, there is no weird kid. Yeah, we are all weird.
Everyone's
kids.
Weird.
Everyone's weird.
So I was doing it that way. And, I even had like film kids say to me, like, oh, why are you doing a business degree when you can do TV? And I was like, no, I want to do business. Then I had the animation and the games kids say, what are you doing a business degree for? Shouldn't you be in games? I'm like, yeah, trust me, I know what I'm doing.
Can I just say, like, business skills in terms of admin, organization, budgeting is actually the most important part of the entire entertainment industry. Like, people don't understand that. Like, so much of what we do is admin related, management related.
Yeah.
You know, it's not really the creative part.
So when I landed this role, that's when I explained to them, I was like, you can do business for an entertainment stream and still enjoy it just as much. Like, there's no way I'm going to be good at coding or programming. No, like, I'm a big daydreamer. So if I'm staring at a computer for too long trying to figure out why this apostrophe is killing the entire website, it's going to frustrate me. And it's happened a few times. But it can totally be, like, you can be done. For sure. So that's why I was like, it's not a waste. I just had to keep it in mind that it was not a waste, you know. And I got to go to LA as an exchange kid. And when I told them there that I told that at LA film school I went to, I told them I want to do business for games or for TV or something, you know, and they were like, that's cool, you know, so they appreciated it.
But yeah, because Hollywood understands, right? Like, Hollywood totally gets it.
They thought it was awesome that there was someone at least who wanted to be like a project manager or production manager or something for a video game, because there's got to be someone who has to keep the team together.
Exactly. And that person is very important to a team.
Do you still do art in your spare time?
I got back into painting a couple of weeks ago. Finally set up my tablet and I started painting again. So it's cool. Drawing, not so much.
Yeah.
Drawing is a thing that I guess it's like a skill or a practice that you have to constantly do, you know. Mm-hmm. Otherwise that arm is going to look really deformed and you're not going to know why.
Yeah, that's fair.
But yeah, but painting, I still love doing painting.
I mean, I can't wait to see some of that art, so, you know, better get doing it.
Okay. Yes, boss.
Toby,
yo.
How about you?
Well, my love for gaming started when I was 10 years old. My parents, they didn't understand what games were. Typical sort of boomer approach to it. No idea it's going to rot your kids' brain, stuff like that. But all my friends had copies of Pokemon. And on my 10th birthday, I pestered my parents so much that I got bought Pokemon Yellow on a Pokemon Game Boy, and I also got an enormous stuffed Pikachu. And I was able to... I was only allowed to play Pokemon as long as I read every word and could tell my parents the words that I'd read. That quickly stopped when they realized how much nonsense words are in Pokemon. But ever since I played Pokemon, I played it for hours. So that was the only game I had for a couple of years. And I just played that on end. So I've got a huge love for Pokemon. And ever since then, I would just try and seek out any games that I could with what limited money I had as a kid. And my parents not buying me any. So I would often make friends with the kids who had game consoles and go around to their house and spend weekends at their house playing games with them. So a lot of Super Nintendo, a lot of Nintendo 64, playing Smash Brothers. Since then, it was just gaming all the way. That was my biggest passion. That was the only thing I wanted to do. I loved it. Probably wanted to do it too much. Left out a few other important parts of my life as a kid. I didn't play much sport because of that, but that's it. It made me who I am now. So with the whole job aspect, I finished high school in Albany in Western Australia, grew up there, and then moved to Perth to study mass communications. And I went there with the grand dream of becoming a games journalist, which
oh, you're one of those people, Toby.
Yeah, which was a ridiculous thought. And I realized that probably like a month or two into it, and I just went, being a games journalist isn't something that you can do as someone from a country town in Western Australia. It just doesn't happen. So I looked at other options and did some more journalism and over that time realized that I really enjoyed doing marketing and film. So for the rest of my degree, I focused my efforts on the marketing and film part of mass communications. So learn how to film stuff, learn how to advertise, wanted to go into the advertising industry, and ended up with jobs doing marketing for a comedy company. Did some jobs as an art department runner for a couple of major feature films that were filmed in Perth, Paper Planes and Kill Me Three Times. And they were both experiences. But doing those also made me realize I didn't want to be part of the feature film industry. I like telling stories about real world issues and real world things. So yeah, that was my sort of experience. After I did the films, which was straight out of uni, I realized that I wanted to know more about video games. I just couldn't stop thinking about me being in the industry in some way. So I went, okay, if I can't make games, because like Sanita, I'm just not a programmer. It's just not something that I feel like I can do or spend enough time learning. And if I can't be a games journalist, maybe I'll be the expert. So I went back to uni to do an honors degree studying, doing cultural studies in video games. And I still wanted to use my film, what I'd learned in film school. So I did an artistic honors degree where I made a bunch of short films about video game communities around Perth. And not online communities. It was very specifically about video game communities where they meet up regularly. And I wanted to find out why, when we've got the internet and online is so big, why do people still meet up to play video games in person? And that was what the thesis was. So yeah, then after that, got really good marks, realized that I was good at the whole academia side of things, and went in to do a PhD. And then I met Janet, and now I'm not doing the PhD anymore. In a really roundabout way, I eventually became a games journalist.
Yeah, pretty yeah. much. Wow. So, you know, to all the kids listening out there, kind of explore your options, because you can kind of get into a profession from all different types of angles. Yeah.
I guess there's this sort of mentality that if you do one thing, you've got to stick to one thing. Mm. Like, you know, if Toby had done journalism, people would just think, oh, he's probably just going to do news or something.
Yeah.
But you can always tailor that to your interests, you know.
Yeah.
So it's like, just try your hand at everything. Yeah. And then when you get in the industry, that's when you can really focus on
what you're doing. And honestly, even when you're in the industry, I mean, look, I've been with Good Game. This is my 6th year with Good Game now. I've been with the ABC, I think this is my 7th year or 8th year. I can't even remember anymore. That's how long I've been at the ABC. And I literally started straight out of uni. And what I've kind of learned over the years is all skills are transferable to a certain extent, and really it doesn't matter what profession you're in. Actually, the skills you use are pretty much across the board.
Apart from if I want to be a surgeon.
Yeah, well,
a surgeon similar.
Exactly. Well, I mean, you know, it's a bit hard if you want to be a dentist and you didn't train as one. You know, I don't think that's the same. But in terms of, for example, you know, as I said previously, management of resources and personnel, you know, kind of everyone does that in a lot of jobs.
Yeah.
So moving on, I mean, we've kind of covered your first gaming loves and why you wanted to work in the media. Did you guys always think you were going to, I guess, head into the media as kids, or did that kind of come about later on?
I always wanted to. I went and did communications, went and did journalism. I feel like my strongest, when I started uni, I felt like my strongest skill was telling stories, whether it be through film or writing. So I really wanted to do that. But man, uni and listening to professionals talk, a lot of people are pessimistic about it and they really get you down. Mm-hmm. So about halfway through uni, I was sort of just like, nah, it's advertising. That's where the money is.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Me personally, it was sort of like a fluctuation over my life of, yeah, I could be in the media. No one can be in the media.
The media is dead.
Yeah.
Yeah. How about you, Paul?
I definitely was from a really early age wanting to make stuff all the time. Yeah, that was definitely a theme. I didn't realize, like, you know, as I described which art form exactly, but there was definitely, like, always making stuff was always there, and just never stopped from, like, really early on. Yeah.
If you are a creative person to a certain extent, it's actually really hard to not create. It's like you just can't help yourself but make stuff.
Yeah, I remember like working like some awful jobs at uni, particularly my first degree when it was still like pretty fresh out of high school, like just working terrible jobs and like writing. It's such a stereotype, like doing storyboards, like writing storyboards on napkins and things like that, and like taking them home and then like drawing them up properly when I got there, and like drawing camera angles and stuff, and like people looking over my shoulder and going, oh, fucking creative people.
Like yourself, Paul, I used to joke in high school that my dreams would end in credits. Like, that's how obsessed I was with films.
Wow.
And growing up, that's all I wanted to do was get into TV and film. Sanita, you said that you drew a lot as a kid, and you painted and you did a lot of art. Was that something that you always wanted to get into?
It's really funny because it was just more of a hobby, you know. But, you know, when you get to that point when it's like, okay, what do I do with my life now? And it's like, should I pursue, can I be an artist?
Mm.
But then I realized I had this joke when I was a kid. I watched The Matrix when I was like a youngin. And I thought, oh yeah, I'm going to be a film director. And then I had to do film essays in high school, which I hated. And I was like, I'm never going to do one of these ever again. And then I entered my first year of uni and I had to do a film essay as part of my requirement. And I was like, okay, I'm going to get good at these again. But I don't see myself as being a director. I didn't see myself being part of, I guess, the industry. I just wanted to be someone creative, but I wasn't entirely sure. So I was just floating around until then I got involved with TV, and I was like, okay, this is how it's going to go. I'm kind of like a floating flower. I just sort of flow with it. But I definitely knew I do want to be part of the video games industry, you know, or anything related to it at least. So that sort of turned around for me a couple of years ago. I was becoming really invested in video gaming. I was criticizing or critiquing games, you know, and seeing which ones I loved more, or why this game would work for me or why it didn't work for me.
Mm.
And I just became more and more invested in it, and I was spending more money on it and going broke because of it. But I'm like, you know what? It's okay if I go broke, because this is something I really love and I can justify buying for it. And so it's just how I envision myself later. So I'm hopefully getting in that area somewhere.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I never saw myself going into entertainment, really.
Mm. Yeah, wow, cool. So, important question. Were you guys fans of Good Game? Did you guys watch Good Game?
I did. Yeah. Of long ago when there was different hosts. But once study got really busy, it was hard to keep up. And it's really funny because it was hard to keep up and I couldn't sit down and watch it on TV. And then, like, how it's now accessible on YouTube, and I'm like, oh, okay, this is so much better now. Like, I can actually watch it in my own convenience.
Yeah.
You know, so, yeah. So, but just periodically until towards when I had more free time, I was, like, watching it religiously and, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, cool. Paul?
Yeah, definitely. I definitely had a gap.
You can say no if you
don't. Yeah, no. Well, no. Fortunately, I don't have to make it up.
He's being held at gunpoint. Yeah.
See, yes.
I'd stopped watching it for years, and then just over the last few years, a new friend of mine, or someone who I became really close friends with over the last few years, and we'd. One of the ways that we, when we hung out, we'd talk video games all the time. And he was like, oh, you should watch he'd always go like, let's watch the Good Game reviews on YouTube. And I was like, oh, are the reviews that good? Like, really? And then, we started watching them. And I was like, oh, that was a really well thought out review. That was really well structured. That was well told. They had great examples. Oh, that's really cool. And so it became a reference point for, just like watching the reviews on YouTube. So for the last few years, I can say yes.
Yeah.
I was watching Good Game and it was great.
And now you get to craft those good reviews.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, like I had, before I started, I think a group of friends got together and we played the Beginner's Guide.
Yeah.
And after playing it, we watched the Good Game review. And this was only just before I was about to start. And And then everyone looked at me and was like, "Are you gonna? What would you have changed? Are you gonna do it? Would you have done it the same?" And I was paying very close attention, and I was like, "Actually, no. That I can't think of a way of improving that.
I'm just gonna rock in and make it better because I'm Paul." Toby, how about you?
I'm a huge fan of the show. I've been watching since it started, and I'm fairly sure I've watched every single episode, and normally on the air date as well. Like I've loved Good Games since it started. I think it's amazing that there is a show about games on Australian television for Australian gamers.
Totally.
And it's been running for 10 years now, which is amazing. That means that I started watching when I was 14.
Wow.
Yeah. And so to now sort of be here with the people who made a show that I love so much for 10 years, and to then also be working with those people and directing Goose and Budjo and Hex and working with the people who've been directing it for so long is just it's surreal, I guess is the right word.
You are living the dream.
I am. Like this when we were on stream I mentioned something about this and I think a comment that really stuck out was Toby is an ascended fan.
There are hope for other fans.
Yeah, weird way to put it, but yeah, that's what it feels like. So yeah, I love the show.
You saying that like it's Australian content for Australian people. I think that I felt the same when I was watching it in as a kid. You know, the weird kid in the background, the only person talking about video games again. It was like I felt I was part of a community when I was watching it, and I was like, okay, people actually understand me. So that's the feeling. And then I come here and I'm like, yeah, people understand me.
you're part of the nerd family now. I had the great luck of actually working on Good Game before I actually started officially. I was actually Good Game was one of my rotations when I was on a ABC graduate program. Which was part of ABC Commercial at that time. And so I got to spend about 4 to 5 months with Good Game before I actually got my full-time job the year later. And I remember actually I just sat in the corner of the office for about a month, just not saying anything so I could kind of get the layout of the land and kind of understand what people were doing. And I remember clearly saying to my then manager, because I was having weekly meetings with him, you know, and we'd talk through my rotations and what I was doing in the different departments. And I remember clearly saying to him, like, I've never been in a place where there are so many nerds and there are so many people who are like even nerdier than I am. Like I literally, you know, like you, Sanita and you guys, I grew up thinking I was the biggest nerd at school, you know, anywhere I went. And then you come into Good Game and you're like, I'm not the only one. There are more like me.
They, what I like to call, Bajo's, I call it awkward humor, but positive awkward humor. And you know, when I tell a joke to my friends and they're just like, whatever, and move on, you know. But here I can laugh with everyone because there's that awkward humour. There's the weird topics we have. And it's just, you just fit in.
I realised because I'd watched this show for so long and taken in so many hours of content that it would be quite easy to come in and be part of the crew and be part of the Good Game family because I've actually shared a lot of the same experiences as you guys, which is, it's a weird way of looking at it, but I felt more confident because I feel like who I was as a gamer had been somewhat shaped by content Good Game had made, which was it was a good feeling rather than coming into a movie studio or a TV show you don't know anything about.
Well, I guess because we make so much content, and I think you mentioned this earlier, Paul, today, that we make so much content. And I think we make that content, we end up putting our own lives up because we make so much of it and we can't just make all of that stuff up. Like, we don't even have the time. So basically whatever happens day in, day out ends up on the screen sometimes.
Like people have asked me if particularly the presenters are like they are in real life, and they are absolutely who they are in real life.
Like Bajo's even weirder in real life.
That's true.
Actually, someone asked me, they said, can Bajo stop being a giggling schoolgirl? I was like, Bajo is a giggling schoolgirl. What are you talking about? Like, he is a giggling schoolgirl.
Yeah, he's just being himself. Like, that is not an act, people. Like, that is very true. So I guess coming into the Good Game office for the first time, you know, you guys have seen the show. Toby, you're a massive fan. Like, what were your initial reactions?
I was sort of intimidated because, you know, That's why I'm glad I sit next to Toby. and Toby was there the first day.
Well, because we had a little bit of a reshuffle from last year into this year. And before you guys started, a few of us were already in the office and we were kind of laying out the tables and stuff.
Yeah.
And we actually decided to put you guys together because, A, Sam didn't want to move. So you can blame Sam.
Yeah.
And also because we decided, since you guys were starting, you know, on Good Game, that you can kind of support each other through the wackiness of the Good Game office.
You guys don't know anything. What happened to divide and conquer?
we like to support our employees here, Paul.
Well, we put Paul up on level 9.
Paul's not even on our level. He's locked up in his edit suite on level 9. He doesn't. He sees us like three times a week, right, Paul? Yeah. Nick Boy has said when he first came in last year, he's mentioned that the Good Game office is one of the most cliquiest places he's ever been in. And I guess that can be really intimidating for someone who's new, right?
Yeah.
That's what he said to us when we first started. He was like, I bet when you come here, you're feeling like you know, everyone's in a clique. But he was like, but you won't feel like that after a couple of months. Mm. It was like, thanks for your words.
Especially as socially awkward nerds, it makes it even harder to like jump in. Yeah. Even,
although I do remember the first time I hung out with the whole crew. I think, if I remember correctly, like Baijo was being like super extra welcoming. Like he really like made a really strong effort to go, hey, what's going on? What are you doing? Blah, blah, blah. And that just made it super easy because it was just like, you know, the person that you see, or you know, one of the people that you see on screen all the time, making a big effort to say, "Hey, hello, how you doing? What's going on? Welcome." That straight away put me at ease.
So the Good Game family, we're clicky, we're a family, we all like to support each other. But who was the most intimidating person when you first came into the office?
I think it was for me. It might have been the host. I don't know. I guess I just see them.
Because like, you've seen them on TV.
And you put them on a nice pedestal. And they have this beautiful blossoming relationship. And I was like, I don't know how to react to talent. Because like, I've worked with talent before. And you sort of just leave them alone in their own trailers. Or they're sitting in their rooms and something. Like, so I just don't really speak to them. But, you know, the fact that we get to interact with them and get to know them, it's just pretty nice. It's very nice.
It's weird having, like, when you've seen someone on TV for so long and then you could talk to them like a normal person. It takes a while for you to get used to that.
I can't remember who it was, but I met someone, like, this is ages ago. I can't remember if it was a musician or something. It was, and I was like, I met them, and I was like, oh, I follow you on Twitter. As if, like, and I was like, oh yeah, I feel like I have quite an intimate knowledge of their life, and that I have no idea who I am. And then I realized that was a really that was a shitty thing to say, or just like a stupid thing to say. But yeah, you just have that feeling of like, oh yeah, I know this person, they're funny, I know what they had for lunch, like I know about their pets, I know about their sore tooth, but then you're just a complete stranger.
Yeah.
That's weird.
It's super weird. It seems to happen more and more these days as we like follow more people on Twitter. Because when I was working in the comedy industry, I would follow most of the comedians. And when I was running events, I would like talk to someone about their day because I knew about it. I didn't consciously think, oh, I only know about it because they wrote it all on Facebook and I was looking at their Facebook. They don't know who I am. I'm no one.
I have that issue with my friends in real life. Sometimes I don't see my friends for a long time and I'm like, I feel like you've done this because I saw it on Twitter and I saw it on Facebook, or they would say, oh yeah, I went to this restaurant, you know, with my friend the other day, and I'll be like, yeah, you posted that on Facebook, right? Yeah, I totally saw that. Yeah. It's like, what do you actually update your friends on in your life if you've kind of posted a lot of that on social media already?
Yeah. You kind of run out of the things to talk to each other about.
Well, it's like, is that just assumed knowledge? Like, if you see someone for the first time in about 3 months, is it just assumed knowledge that they've read all of your Facebook posts and Twitter posts?
Yeah, I get really offended if I have to actually explain what I've been doing. I'm like, don't you like my Facebook feed?
Yeah. Don't you follow my Instagram feed? Like, come on.
Well, one time my best friend forgot my birthday.
Ooh.
And I was like, dude, it's on Facebook. Like, use that or something as a reminder. But it's all cool. Like, she's hilarious. So I forgive her.
Yeah, my excuse is, if your birthday isn't on Facebook, then you can't you know, you can't complain if I forget your birthday. Mm. Yeah, because I'm generally, fair. Like, terrible with birthdays. Yeah. I don't have them on my calendar or anything. Mm. So unless it's on Facebook or something, I'm not going to remember it. Mm. Sorry.
No, that makes perfect sense.
Yeah.
I think coming into the office with intimidating people, I was intimidated by everyone because yeah. I liked the show so much and I wanted to have a good time at this job. And this is the same with coming into any workplace. I wanted everyone to like me.
Yeah.
And so, like, I'd get home at the end of the day and think about all the conversations I'd had and go...
And rerun
did
them
I
over
say,
and over.
Did I say anything offensive? Did someone, like, look at me funny? Oh, does that person like me? And it's completely crazy. But it's just wanting... It's just like wanting to be part of the family. And it happens at every job.
The producers as well.
Yeah.
I imagined when you were describing that, I totally imagined you like in a darkened room sitting on, like on an empty mattress on the floor with like mold over notes. The walls.
It's like,
I wonder who they like me.
I just want them to like me. I do have to say all three of you have made great starts because you've all kind of been quiet and done your jobs. And that's seriously the best way to start any job. And I think we've always had a lot of work experience kids and occasionally interns come into Good Game, and I've seen a lot of them over 5 years, and the best ones just kind of sit there, do their jobs, and occasionally ask questions if they want to know more or don't understand something. Mm. But and then they sit there and observe. Those are the best.
Yeah.
I've had on occasion 16-year-olds telling me how to direct in the studio.
Oh,
like, amazing. If you're that kid, I don't care if you're the, you know, reincarnation of Orson Welles. Like, never, ever, ever tell a director what to do in the studio. That is just not on.
No way.
like, that basically gets you kicked out of the studio.
I don't even say anything. I just watch.
Yeah. Well, actually, the best way of actually learning on the job is to observe. Yeah. And is to observe really closely how the relationships work in an office and what people do and what's needed and what's important. Like,
and it's just, it's always ask questions as well, because no question is stupid unless you're asking like something about dentistry.
Yeah.
You know, but because I
totally irrelevant question.
Because sometimes I ask so many questions to the coordinators, like to Sam and Red. I'm asking them a lot of questions, and sometimes I think, am I being like too much? But then again, if I'm doing it on my own, I'm not going to know what I'm doing. So I have to ask.
Yeah.
And they're always going to, they're all going to help. Everyone's going to help out. If you've got a question, they're always going to help out. They'll always say something.
And
you know,
like, I can't remember, was it Clint Eastwood or something? No, wait, I'm getting two different sayings mixed up. But anyway, assumptions are the mother of all fuck-ups.
Oh, like, that's a great one,
any time if I'm like, I try and check, did they explicitly say that or am I assuming that that's what they're talking about?
Mm-hmm.
And I just think, it's always worth checking and asking one extra question over just assuming that you know what someone means and then doing the wrong thing and wasting lots of time or wasting money or what have you. It's just ask. Yeah. And
I think it's really important, like when you start, is to ask those questions. I mean, obviously, 6 months, 9 months, a year down the track, and if you're still asking the same questions, then
exactly.
That's a difference. But I think you guys have made fantastic starts.
Yay!
That's great news.
Okay, so a lot of people have asked us if we have crazy initiations in the Good Game office. I'm just going to say we don't.
No.
But you guys, having just started, if we did, what would be a good initiation?
Oh, you want us to come up with one for the next new people?
Yeah, just come up with one for the next batch.
A Dark Souls speed run.
That is good. That is the
prove
ultimate.
Prove your worth.
Oh, man. Sanita, when you become like head of the ABC,
I'm going to be brutal.
That's a trial.
Evil.
I think get locked in a room with Barjo and maybe Rad and Nick Boy, who've drunk a lot of caffeine, and see if you can withstand a couple of hours. Because I think they might be the most...
Probably. I mean, that's hard because I feel like Rad and Nick Boy would cancel each other out.
Yeah?
Yeah, because they would just go off in a corner and duel. And then Barjo
would be showing his chest to everyone.
He would. Yeah, you. I feel like all you have to do would to defeat Barjo. I mean, we have these conversations a lot. I mean, I don't know if they've come up since you guys have been here, but we always go through a battle royale situation or scenario with the Good Game team. And we always go, okay, who's going to be last person standing? What do you guys think? Who would be last person standing?
In just being awake? Or in a fight?
Well, it's a battle fight. Battle Royale.
So in Toby, a fight.
You know the Japanese film, Battle Royale, where school kids fight to the death?
Yeah.
It's kind of like what they some people claim that Hunger Games, Good Games ripped off.
Yeah.
Mm. So good game, Battle Royale. Who would win?
No. I'd be curious to see what John's got up his sleeve.
That's
actually
what I was thinking,
yeah,
John.
Yeah, John's pretty menacing.
But he would be... Because he's quite large in stature, he'd be slow, so you can outrun him.
And also, I don't think John is as violent as people think.
Yeah, he's
actually
quite a lovable teddy bear.
Yeah.
Well, I had him. I had him as like I don't know him that well.
Yeah.
So he's like a question mark to me. It's not that he's going to be the winner, but he's the question mark.
What about Sam?
Oh, dark horse.
He's got the muscles.
Yeah.
But see, if it's a battle royale situation, everyone would take out Sam first, right?
Yes.
Because he's like the fittest.
Oh, you have thought about this a lot.
As I said, we talk about this a lot. So I'm going to actually revisit this question 6 months down the track when you guys get to know everyone else a little bit better. Toby?
I think it might be you that might win.
I've often said it is me, but let us revisit this in 6 months' time. Have a think about it. Joe's also a dark horse. Yeah,
you would murder people.
I would get pretty dirty in fights. So yeah. I don't care.
I'm lazy, so I'd die within the first maybe the first 10 minutes.
But you could hide.
Oh yeah,
and you could
hide
get
and
pretty
nap.
Far. Yeah. Another question about the Good Game Office, because I think people like to know, what's the weirdest thing in the Good Game Office that you've come across?
Barjo.
Other than Barjo, because we all know he's the weirdest thing.
Yeah. His chest reminds me of the alien scene where it's about to pop out. Like, because everyone does all these memes about Barjo's chest or like Barjo's face within Barjo's chest. It's just like, oh gosh.
I watched the pocket episode, the nipple episode, I'm going to call it. I think
that's hilarious.
I think really late at night, and we've just finished
a day. Oh, you were in San Fran.
Yeah,
that's
we were at GDC, and pretty much everyone had gone to bed. And I checked out the stream, the 90s stream that they were doing, and then I saw that the episode was uploaded, and it was like 11:30 at night. I was really tired. And I was like, I guess I'll just watch it. I know it's going to be really weird and wacky and fun. I watched it, and I went, oh man, I wish I didn't watch it. It's like 11:30 p.m. at night, and I'm like, I know my dreams will be populated by Steven's chest. Yeah. Like, there is just no way about it.
There was a huge, apparently signed Justin Bieber poster in my edit suite.
Oh, it's a legacy.
Yeah, that was like, so I was like, this is, you know, it was right above the monitors, really big. And I just, you know, at first I was like, the first thing I thought, okay, I'm going to have to take that down. How long do I wait? You know, is it important that it's there? Can I just do it myself? Or, are people going to be upset if I just take it down? Am I being hazed? Is this leftover hazing from someone else? And I just have someone's leftover hazing. And so I actually don't remember how long it took, but I think it was about 3 weeks before I was like, hey, Andy, you know, about that Justin Bieber poster in there, do you mind if I just take that down? Is that going to upset anyone?
Did you take it down?
Oh, yeah.
I
gave it back to John, apparently. It was a gift. I don't understand the whole dynamics of that
thing.
Yeah,
I don't even remember where it came from, but it was years in the making.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like it was a 2011 or 2012 thing that happened.
Yeah, wow.
You know, like the second Justin Bieber album?
Oh,
Never Say Never, was that the name?
Oh, gosh. I don't know.
He's getting better. There is like one or two tracks from his current album. Which
I'm a total closet Justin Bieber fan. Now I'm not at a closet Justin Bieber fan. I'm just a Justin Bieber
Teeth sucking noise.
Yeah.
I found the weirdest thing, and this was the first day I was here. I look up, and there is a pillow. Half Gus and half Pete with no clothes on, joined together like cat dog. And this is the first thing I see when I sit down at my desk and look up and I go, what the fuck am I doing here? And now it just floats around. Like, for quite a while it was up directly behind my computer eyeline. So every time I looked away from my computer, it was just there. But now I think it's in the game capture room.
The thing is, like Goose and Bajo always like to play birthday gift pranks with each other, and so they'll always try and outdo each other with birthday gifts. Mm-hmm. And this year, both Pete and Goose got together and made this pillow.
It's a good one.
It's horrific, though,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah,
it is
horrifying.
Wait to see it.
It's in the games room. We'll show you after the podcast.
Right. Yeah.
We had a guest in, and he came and sat down on the couch, and then sort of just looked to the right, and there was just Gus and Pete just sitting next to him. He didn't say anything. He just sort of looked back, but you could tell that it had changed him.
That poor kid.
Hello, darkness, my old friend.
Oh, the super weirdness of this episode.
Oh my god. That is way worse than I imagined.
The pillows come.
I'm being hugged by this weird worm.
See, I don't know if I can take a picture of it and post it online because I feel like we'd get in trouble.
It's such a.
Isn't it horrific? Paul,
it's really good. Yeah. That is fantastic work.
But then Nick,
that is creepy as hell.
Yeah.
Nick during one of the pocket streams was saying we should make more, but then who would we pair up?
Oh,
so you? No,
I think Paul's going to take the pillow home. he's getting a bit too attached to it now.
Yeah, good game is at least when you come into the office here, even if it's your first day, you're going to find some interesting stuff, which you wouldn't normally find in other offices.
Yeah, I've been to other offices and other corporations, and it's just not as fun. Here is just awesome.
And I've also worked at places that think that they're super goofy.
Yeah.
And it's like...
And that's really put on, right? Really
yeah, cool, it's yeah. like, oh, we have a cactus.
I should get a cactus.
Wow,
now.
You guys are so amazing.
Well, the thing is, people in the ABC actually take tours of our office.
Mm.
Like, they actually bring people around our office. Like, occasionally we just see a group of people. We don't know who they are. We don't know where they're from. And half the time they kind of walk through our office and go, oh, look how fun this place is. Isn't it great?
We had a random child come in and we were like, ooh, Star Wars.
Yeah.
The mother's trying to get that kid out. And he's like playing with the toys. We're like, no, you
can't touch the toys.
Don't touch the toys, child.
Shouldn't be in here.
Yeah, it is a fun office to be in.
In my third week here, I had to lead a group of 20 kids
through
the ABC for a tour because whoever was meant to do it was sick. So I was just sort of trying to think of facts, and I was like, I'm just going to have to make these up.
Is this the ones that you took down to the studio as well?
Yeah.
Oh.
So you made up stuff. You lied to children.
Maybe.
And here's the radio studio. It was made in 1971.
Yeah,
and that was a big tour group. I remember.
Yeah, I was terrified.
Lynn and I were on set and they were just touching everything. And I'm like, there are so many risks like going on right now.
I always have to be the adult in the room when it comes to tour groups in the studio because I have to make that health and safety announcement first up. It's everyone, watch out for the cable. Watch out for the equipment. Please don't touch anything that you're not allowed to touch.
What a buzzkill, didn't you?
Yeah, I know. I can't help it. Someone has to be the adult in the room, right? And I have to be that adult. Yeah, it's a bummer. It's a bummer. What can I say? What do you guys nerd out about? What are your nerd secrets? Justin Bieber's mine, so... Actually, that's really not true. I know people are going to write in thinking I'm a huge Justin Bieber fan.
Have a good think.
For me, it's sort of waned in the last couple of years, but it's definitely Pokemon. Like, first game I ever played, and I just know quite a lot about it, just from lots of reading random forum posts and being part of the community and playing lots of Pokemon.
Which is going to be great. You're going to be so helpful on Good Games 1.0.
Yeah, I didn't realize how little you guys knew about Pokemon. I was offended, but no, that's great. I can help. I've got some use.
I'm a bit too old for Pokemon, so that's my excuse.
Look, I'm going to have to think about it more. I don't know.
Okay, Sanita.
I think for me it's merchandise.
Ooh,
like,
okay.
I love collecting game merchandise. I know that this is funny because how Goose's IMO was saying, stop pre-ordering. I was like, nah, mate, I'm still going to buy a lot of stuff. Like,
did you go up to Goose and tell him your opinion?
I was like, I'm still going to pre-order. Like, I don't care what you say. Like,
your IMO has not changed my opinion.
Like, I still love it. I buy hoodies a lot. a lot of gaming hoodies. I'm wearing one right now. Like, I'm wearing a Mass Effect hoodie. And I buy, like, scarves. I like buying things that are wearable. I don't like cosplay, but I like wearable cosplay. So, my jackets, hoodies, like, little pieces. And so, I love collecting that. I love art books. I love, like, collecting the statues, the little things, like the Nathan Drake bullet USB. Like, that was awesome.
Yeah. You are single-handedly keeping the games industry alive, Sanita.
So I like those things. Because to me, I'm a very nostalgic person, so I like nostalgic items. And gaming is all about, is nostalgia for me. So that's why I love having all of that. Like, my ringtone is the Crash Bandicoot 2 theme song, you know, because that is just like, oh, that's such a good memory. So I keep all of that. And I have a tattoo of The Last of Us quote. So I keep that all on me because it's like, it's all nostalgic. And I love merchandise and that. So, yeah. Paul.
So I think probably, if anything, it's like hardware stuff. Like, I'm sort of from that... The stereotype person that makes their PCs and is really obsessed with every individual component, you know, trying to measure the airflow through the case.
Have you talked to Bajo about this?
A little bit, yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
Good.
We've had a few chats about, like, SLI versus having, you know, an NVIDIA physics secondary card and things like that, to the point where I'm subscribed to, like, secret forums where workers on the floors of, like, silicon manufacturing plants will, like, put what they understand is being worked on. So even before a product is announced, they're like, oh, we're working on a 14 nanometer thing. It's come onto the construction line, so you'll hear about, like, you know, the newest types of, like, 3D transistors that are going to be used in the next level of RAM and that kind of stuff. So it's just being on top of that kind of hardware stuff. And now that I think about it, I don't really talk about it with anyone. That is actually a secret. That's something that I just do by myself, like, on a daily basis, is check, like, yeah.
Now about 500 of our fans. It's not the whole public, but, you know, it's a greater amount of people than
send
just
hardware.
With Bajo helping out on computers, I mentioned to him that I'm thinking about getting a new computer, and a week later he'd asked for quotes and sent me a bunch of different computer parts that he'd recommended.
Oh, that's
which
sweet.
Was really
sweet.
Nice. Yeah. Now he asks me quite often, have you got the computer yet? And I'm like, I don't have any money, Bajo.
Yeah. Because Bajo's kind of idea of a good computer or a good graphics card is, you know, over $1,000.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I'll listen to him, though. I'll probably end up buying it.
Yeah. Mm. Oh, he'll pressure you into it.
Yeah,
like, he always does. Yeah. Everyone always comes away from a Bajo PC conversation
with a
computer or a, you know, an incredibly expensive graphics card that they may have not needed, but Bajo has insisted that they did need it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. My rule of thumb is, if they don't have to especially ship your CPU in from overseas, it's probably shit.
All right. Well, Paul's got the last word on that one.
Yeah.
So, last question of the podcast. What is your favorite food and why?
Oh, gosh.
That's a very important question.
It's kind of like asking what's your favorite game, in a way, because it's like there's so many to choose from.
They've all got such different elements.
Yeah.
I was super excited when the first week we were here on a Friday, we went out and had burgers. Because burgers are my favorite food. Because you can put so many different things in a burger. Mm. And it's normally unhealthy, and everyone knows unhealthy food tastes the best.
Yeah.
So I'm going to say burgers.
Mm.
I can't really choose one, because I guess it depends on my emotion or what I'm feeling that day. It's like, it's kind of like I said, like, what do I feel like at the moment, and what do I want to play or what do I want to eat?
What about just today? Mm. We'll make it easier.
Today? Mm. I just want ice cream.
Yeah.
I think that if I had to pick, like, a sweet or a dessert, it'd definitely be ice cream.
Do you have, like, a particular flavour that you always go to?
Oh, no, it always changes every year, because I ask myself this question every year, actually. It's like, what kind of ice cream do I feel like this year? You know, just like, last year, I checked back my old question from last year, because I had this book that asks, like, questions every day, and one of them was ice cream. And last year it was like, I really loved caramel and I really loved coconut.
Yeah.
This year, I think I just want, like, plain chocolate. I think I like mixed ice cream. Like, I want to have different flavors, kind of like, you know, with when people like smashed cookies in it or something.
Yeah,
and
right. Okay, cool.
White chocolate. Oh, yeah, I do like white chocolate recently.
Mm. Okay, we can go with white chocolate.
Yeah. Yeah. Or ice cream.
I've actually become really, really boring as I get older. Like, I actually find joy in just having vanilla ice cream or original chips. Like, I was never that... Yes. I always hated original flavors or vanilla as a kid. Mm. Like, that would be the last flavor that I go to. Mm. And nowadays,
like
I'm like...
gourmet vanilla.
Yeah, like a good gourmet vanilla or like a good... again gourmet like original chips. I'm like I just like the basics now.
Totally.
I've become boring and old. This is terrible.
I don't want to say boring at all. You're probably just original.
Hey, good one.
No,
good one.
I'm definitely into the mushed up flavor. Like there was one flavor I had at Messina's. This is a while ago, but it had like a chips, like just like salty chips.
Just so people know, Messina is a like a gelato.
Yeah, they
chain
do lots of different
Sydney
flavors.
Yeah.
Well.
Oh, I think they're in Melbourne as well now. So,
Yeah, very fancy ice cream place. And they had one flavor that had, I think it was salt and vinegar chips dipped in white chocolate.
Oh.
And it sounds gross. I was like, oh, I have to try that. It was actually amazing.
Yeah.
Like, I was surprised, but it has that kind of thing of like salted caramel, you know, where it's like that's the salty and the sweet together, and it works in this really weird way.
I'm hungry now.
Mm.
Yeah. See, I always end on food because it's usually around, you know, 5, 6 p.m. that we end on these podcasts, and so people can just go home and eat.
Yeah, right. I'm going to go with ramen. Ramen is like my favorite meal at the moment.
What type of ramen?
Okay.
It's Japanese or Korean?
Yeah, okay, well, wait for it.
Don't you dare say Maggi, because...
No. No, so there's an excellent... It's a Japanese place in Redfern called Jap's Table, and they do an incredible ramen. Mm. It's really good. But I've also am partial to a Chinese-style ramen that's just near here in Chinatown. I forgot the name of the place right now, but yeah, they do handmade Chinese-style ramen, which is something I didn't really know was a thing until I tried it, and man, it was good.
Oh man, next time on the show, Paul's food tips for Sydney. Yeah. I see it. Thank you so much for joining me on the podcast.
No, thanks for having us.
Thank you for joining the team of Good Game.
Thanks. What a delight.
Thanks for inviting us.
We hope we'll still be here after 6 months.
I think you will be.
I'm doing a talk to a bunch of kids next week about how to sort of get this sort of job, which is just crazy to me.
Yeah.
I feel like I need to point out to them that when you come to somewhere, like a lot of people think it's just playing games.
Yeah.
And it's not. You come here to work and you have to, with my job, you have to, you know, call a lot of people and talk to a lot of people and be thinking about things all the time. And there's very little playing games. I think it's important to point that out to people who might think that this is a dream job, because for a lot of people it won't be.
For me, it's a lot of Excel.
Yeah, it's like everyone works super hard.
Yeah.
Mm. There's no question.
But definitely meeting a team of passionate people who do work super hard and love what they're doing, it's just great to meet you guys, Lynn and Ben and Pete and everybody, and learn from some of the best people that make stuff that I love, and learn from them how to do stuff better. So yeah, thank you.
Oh, thanks, Toby. Mm. Thank you all. You guys can all stay.
Yeah.
it's not even my call.
Yeah.
But I think you guys can all stay.
Great.
And that's a nice point to finish on. Thank you again. And as always, if you've got a topic you want us to chat about on Good Game Roundtable, you can tweet me at @eljology or leave a comment on Facebook or SoundCloud. Goodbye.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.
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 Bye. Bye.